powerful, creative artists, geniuses, and their name says it all. Edouard Duval Carrier and Tobias Ostrander. Doesn't that sound sexy and powerful? I don't know, guys, but my fan base out there was going crazy this morning when I sent my constant contact email to about 20,000 people, besides who tunes in, which is 37,000, and everybody started to, oh my God, I love it. And so I said to myself in April, first of all, good morning, Edouard Duval Carrier.
Good morning.
Good morning, Tobias Ostrander.
Hi, how are you?
Oh, great. The last time I saw you, Tobias, was in April. You sat right there across from me, and we were super excited about All Eyes on Us for December with a brand new construction on its way for the very first contemporary museum in Miami of that magnitude.
Of the Paris Art Museum Miami, yeah.
Yes, Paris Art Miami Museum. Museum Miami. Mm-hmm. Oh, sorry about that. Last time I had a tough time. This time I promise I wasn't going to mess up. There I go. But anyway, now, under your direction, we knew that you were a true asset for Miami and for the PAM. And we knew that with you on board, we were going to start seeing some wonderful, exciting exhibitions. And with that said, Edouard Duval Carrier, who is a friend of mine and a friend of Miami, I mean, you're a Miami-based artist.
For a long, long time now.
Yes, you are definitely our hero in Miami. Oh, and I was so pleased to hear about not only becoming a permanent artist, but this exhibition show with the PAM and Imagined Landscapes opens up on March 13th, this Thursday, with a conversation between Tobias Ostrander, the chief curator of the PAM, and Edouard Duval Carrier, who I understand it took you a year to create this.
Absolutely. When I got invited, it was no question for me to show something that had been shown before here. So I was invited to visit the museum while it was in construction, and I even got to choose my room to do the show, and I'm so pleased because it does look good. I mean, if I may say so.
Yeah, it's a whole new body of work, especially made for this exhibition. So, yeah, Imagine Landscapes.
Now, Imagine Landscapes. Now, did you reach out to Edward? Was that something you said, okay, I want to definitely have influenced here to show this museum? Part of it is to give back and bring some of our great artists.
Yeah, absolutely. I think one of the things that was an interest of mine in Edouard's work is, you know, one should not forget their local art histories. And Edouard, you know, when we look at we always think of Art Basel as like the Miami moment, but there are many artists working here, you know, from the 90s on, and who have very strong international reputations, and Edouard is one of them. You know, we did a wonderful Jose Bedia show about a year ago, and, you know, very similar generation to Edouard, but a different context, you know, a different, you know, cultural background in case of Edouard, Haiti, but interesting to kind of look at his work again and, you know, and think about a new invitation, you know, really kind of provoke, a new body of work. And the other thing that was interesting for us is Edouard's show will open this Thursday, and then next month in April, we'll be opening a large exhibition of called Caribbean Crossroads of the World, which is a large, you know, very large survey of the history of Caribbean art that Edouard is in that exhibition. So this is a chance to see sort of his past work within a larger Caribbean context and see his new work, you know, like really fresh out of the studio.
I'm so excited. I have to tell you, Edouard, you know, seeing your compositions and your work evolve through the years, you're known to bring a lot of color. And with this Imagine Landscape, you've done something that is lush, tropical landscapes, and you've created these Gardens of Eve. And when you think about that, and when you think of your works, it always provokes colors and all. And meanwhile, you have done that even more so, but just using two colors.
Yes, and they're at night, after a light rain. That's what my intention was.
Wow.
So, you know, it's after a light rain under the moonlit sky, so.
And it's all, you use black and silver.
Black and silver.
Black and silver.
Glitter.
Glitter. You know, I saw a year ago, I think it was, maybe longer, 2 years ago, at Bernice Steinbaum's gallery, when she had opened up one of these, I think when you just started to maybe...
Trying.
And I remember looking at it, and it was a very large canvas. It's almost mural size. And I understand that with Imagine Landscape, it's the same thing, mural size paintings, and which is fabulous because I really love those very large canvases that obnoxiously menace luxury because just of their, you know, their whole large scale. And I think that's fabulous. And also to have these beautiful rooms at the PAM that can show those works. Because when you think about it, prior to the PAM, most of the museums here were, you know, very small scale, darker, you know, and you know what, the PAM itself is a work of art. So, you know, shame on anyone who has not gone there. I'm always saying this, Tobias. I don't know if you listen to my show, but every single show I end up with saying, if you haven't joined the PAM and become a member, it's a very small price to pay to support your local art institutions.
It's unique in the planet with that view. When you're in the museum outside, it's unbelievable. And the scale of the museum, I mean, the way it's been built, it's just breathtaking.
It really is. From every single angle, from going up the wooden plank steps to going down the beautiful cobblestone and the water and seeing the cruises there. And then let's not forget the art.
Yes. Exactly. Well, we have to compete with all of that.
Well, you know, now Imagine Landscape is something where you have taken your time, I understand, and please correct me if I'm wrong, to actually do a historical reference to some of the big pioneers in landscaping, portrait landscape artists like William Heade, and actually taking cross-referencing some of the historical, landscape portraits and involving it in the past to the present the way you see it.
Well, I wanted to revisit, you know, like the 19th century, because I think the 19th century has largely been forgotten, you know, like, and all these vision and what we think of what the Caribbean, what even the south of the United States is, even Latin America in general. I mean, those images established, you know, what we think of that region. And I just wanted to revisit them to see, you know, like, were they real? Were they imagined? Were they... So, I mean, you know, like, I mean, there's a lot of questionings behind all of that, a lot of research, you know, and bringing back, you know, like, to the forefront, you know, like, those people that came down, and whether they were commissioned to come and do surveys or whether they did it on their own volition, it was, you know, like, to me, important to see, I mean, what they brought to the table, and is it still, you know, like relevant today?
I mean, really, he's sort of addressing how certain 19th century painters have really created our imaginary of the tropics, you know, and often it is an imaginary, meaning he always talks about they left out, that they edited, you know, the more, you know, difficult things like mosquitoes and slaves and, you know, that kind of thing. And you know, of the plantation system, you know, really, and particularly the artists that he was choosing from, you know, the 19th century were particularly kind of had a kind of romantic view of the landscape and as an exoticized place or an exotic, you know, place for adventure. But what I think was really interesting about this group of works is, and I'd like you to talk about this, is, I mean, a lot of these paintings were built as kind of promotional tools, like to encourage U.S. investment in places like Jamaica or Brazil or Panama. And what's underlying this project, I think, is, you know, that we're still selling the tropics, you know, and there are paintings from Florida as well that he's referencing. So, you know, I mean, we are, you know, a tropical economy. We are kind of a vacation pleasure economy, yeah. And we're continually selling the
product. Well, you know, I my bread and butter is not being a radio host, which I love to do because it gives me the opportunity to always sit with phenomenal people that really changed the world and the landscape and as a canvas in a whole. But what I do is my art tours. And part of the art experience tours is not just bringing people to see museums and collections and galleries, but we talk a lot about the history. And the history being the mother of Miami, Julia Tuttle, who back in the early 20th century, mid-20th century, she was the pioneer and a very smart woman. She had 640 acres, and she commissioned landscape portrait artists to make postcards of the mangroves and the beach, and she would send it to these families in the north, pioneers like Henry Flagler, Theodore Vivian Moore, who came down and did the design district, founding father of Buena Vista East and West. And what she wanted to do was, if you had a lot of money in the 19th century, 20th century, you would take a transatlantic crossing and you would go see the Italian and French Riviera. And what Miss Julia Tuttle did was call it the American Riviera. And so she would send those postcards that she had commissioned by these landscape artists to very rich families. Carl Fisher was one, who came down with $6 million and did the first Lincoln Road Pedestrian Mall in 1912, bought 6 acres from Vanderbilt, did Fisher Island. So it was always using the tropical landscapes to create economic development and to encourage, awareness and curiosity enough to go on your steamboat and come down here.
Well, that's the whole point of this exhibit, you know, and what was left behind, as we say, you know, like what was pushed under the carpet or behind those canvases, you know. I mean, plantation economies, disease, malaria, all these things. I mean, we're very, very present at the time, even more so now. We have much more, you know, like control over the tropical landscape. But, you know, like back then, you know, I mean, you took your life in hand when you came down here.
Yeah.
I mean, in many ways.
And I think, I mean, what we were talking about is, you know, these paintings in particular, you know, sort of drain the images of these landscapes of color. They're black, they're at night, and they sparkle. And you know, as Edouard was saying, they're sort of representations of these landscapes after a rain and in the moonlight, and they sparkle and they're quite beautiful. But at the same time, sort of when we think of the tropics, we think of high color. We think of like green and the turquoise, you know, water and the white sand. And he's kind of denying us that type of imagery. So sort of denying a little bit of the pleasure of the landscape in order to sort of think about the shadows, think about what is not always talked about or seen in that landscape.
I'm also pleasantly surprised, though, because I have not seen Imagine Landscape, but I'll be there with bells on March 13th. But I have to tell you, when I did see you touch upon that same black and silver imagery, the way you used the glitter and the way you contrasted against the black, I could almost see the glistening and hear the sounds of the sea as the moon is shining upon that sea, and you place so delicately the silver glitter among the black canvas, and you could almost hear the water, you could almost see the stars. And with all that lush landscaping, as black as it could be, you play with that silver to almost feel that whole, like I could almost feel a machete coming through get through it. I really, seriously, because you play with that landscape. Believe me, guys, if you haven't seen Edouard Duval Carrier's work, I mean, it is a body full of wonderful series of works, always with the undertones of, you know, plantation, slaves, politics, history of Hazier, you know, the freedom of Hazier, all, everything like that. But when this landscaping, that Garden of Eve, and then the other series of Imagined Landscapes, you know, I've actually feel that is like the glorious thing, because when you're there in that landscape and you're feeling that, it evokes color in your mind.
Well, you certainly do have poetry there.
You know what? I got, you know, you guys do that to me. I'm sorry. Both of you.
Very effusive there. But I do wish, you know, like people would come and see it. It's a very particular body of work, because it's all very integrated, not only, you know, like as a theme, But after seeing it yesterday, I mean, we're putting it up still at the museum. I think it's
really spectacular.
Well, that's very kind of you, but I said it fits in very well.
How many canvases are to be seen?
There will be more than about 12 paintings, 12, you know, like panels.